Good evening. Today is the 22nd day of October 2014, and it is a great pleasure to have with us Dr. Pachegaonkar. Welcome, sir. As we always begin in our first interviews with disciples and devotees, we like to know how you first heard about Mother and Sri Aurobindo.
My teacher in homeopathy, he is basically allopathic surgeon. He has been devotee of Mother and Sri Aurobindo. And from his childhood, with his mother, he used to come here. And he is a very busy homeopathic practitioner cum surgeon. And we could hardly find even one day to be with him. And he used to come to Pondicherry for a month every year with his mother. Mm. So we were curious about Mother and Sri Aurobindo's philosophy. So we started reading books, and once we came along with him to Pondicherry.
What year was this?
This was in 1992.
Okay. And his name?
Dr. Dinyar Mistry. And he has been coming to Pondicherry almost from 1996 regularly. He comes every year for a month and stays here, does reading, discussions, and he is very popular homeopath and even popular surgeon also. So along with him, we started coming, and then we continued to come every year and give service here, be here for 5 to 6 weeks. And then we decided to come for good in 2000.
You say we.
Yeah, 2000.
We is your whole family?
My wife also, yes.
You and your wife?
Yes, yes.
Any children?
Then our daughter is born.
When was she born?
2006.
So you took up work here. And yes. What work were you given?
I joined as a homeopath in the health center of Sri Aurobindo Society, and then we started working in regular OPD, outpatient department, as a homeopathic center. And then we started taking up some research studies also, clinical studies on keloid, on obesity, on cataract, and renal calculi, like that.
You are housed now in along the beach road.
Yes.
In the society's building, is it?
Yes, yes. Uh-huh.
And how many people do you have helping you?
See, we get around 32 patients on an average every day for outpatient consultation.
I see.
And in that new cases, we take around 2 to 3 new cases. And for us, as a homeopath, we have to work out the whole totality of the person, the evolution of the health from childhood, and then work out a sort of a constitutional remedy for that person. So it's a bit time consuming. So we take 2 to 3 new cases and around 30 follow-up cases.
So when you take up a new case, how much time do you spend with him to study the childhood?
Depends. Like, it takes somewhere around 2 hours it takes. But what we do is we give the questionnaire like a format for information. They fill it and bring. So 1.5 to 2 hours it takes. Sometimes we have to take even consecutive sitting also. Means in one sitting we may not be able to take the whole totality. Because we study the whole evolution of a health profile from childhood, like all illnesses, not only the person's illness, but even the family illnesses from childhood, and what sort of treatment person has taken, how he has reacted to those disorders. And now we try to work out a remedy which fits into the whole evolution of the disease totality.
How has Sri Aurobindo's writings, how have they affected you or moved you in your work of homeopathy?
It's a very funny story. Like, see, in homeopathy also, we work on integral health. Means we try to study the whole human being as a whole and then try to work out a remedy which matches with this being. And when we started reading about integral yoga, that where all the planes of the being are to be considered for progress. So all the layers of the being. And with this concept, actually, I work as a teacher also in university, as a faculty member. And I'm professor of philosophy in the university.
Which university?
It is Maharashtra Health Science University. We call it. It's a health university which is for homeopathy, allopathy, Ayurveda and Unani. So I work as a member, faculty member in one PG institute in Bid. So actually the clarity started coming after reading Mother and Sri Aurobindo's philosophy. Like very simple example is from our medical undergraduate studies, we used to consider that in human being, it is the physical body which is governed by the vital force. So mind and body both are governed by vital force. This was what was interpreted and taught to us. But after reading Mother and Sri Aurobindo's philosophy, we started realizing that it is the mind which is actually employing vital and physical plane as an instrument for progress, for attaining the highest goal. In homeopathy, we call it highest goal because the main target of our treatment is that day by day, along with homeopathic treatment, the person should become better and better human being. That is what we call cure. It is not the relief from ailments or disease. We call it the person becomes better and better human being. That is the internal man, the we call soul or whatever. So this philosophy actually brought very good clarity. And more than that, like, you know, even in medical philosophy also, we try to consider human being with the universal life concept. So here, when I started reading Life Divine, and there I started realizing how that monism is applied to even medical science. So earlier, our teachers used to tell that when you are like treating a patient, you should feel as if you are treating yourself and not someone else. And after reading Life Divine, we started realizing that, see, we are part of the whole world. And because part of the world, the patient is again a part of this universe. So when we are treating this part of the universe, the patient, we are treating ourselves because we are again a part of this universe. So we can't separate the patient and we from the universe. So one component of the universe is sick. So that has to be set right, and that means indirectly we are helping ourselves by curing the person. So we started actually getting clarity about homeopathic philosophy after reading Mother and Sri Aurobindo.
And what other books of Mother and Sri Aurobindo have touched you deeply?
See, we have letters on yoga, and we have done compilations, and Dr. Dalal also has done compilation on Sri Aurobindo and Mother's writings on health. And my wife, Aarti, she also has done one project that for 6 months she studied letters on yoga and then compiled data in actually context with health and healing.
I see. You said you had an interesting story. What was the interesting story that you wanted to tell us in reference to this? Or was it your first reading of Life Divine?
No, actually, there, as a PG teacher, there was a topic in the syllabus that the concept of universal concept of life in placement of man in that concept. And no one was able to explain this topic. No one was ready to cover this topic. And after reading Mother and Sri Aurobindo, actually things became so clear that once we presented it in our PG seminar, and then even everyone, many college institutes and all started calling us as a resource person on this topic.
I see. At present, you and your wife work together?
Yes, yes. We work in the same clinic.
The same clinic.
As a homeopath.
And what do you foresee regarding health in the next 20, 30 years? Health of the human being.
See, the concept of disease, health, illness, cure, now is being considered at dynamic level, not at structural level. Earlier, we used to bother so much about the tissue level pathology or structural level pathology, but now everyone has started realizing that that is just a sequelae or a secondary effect of disease phenomena. So we have to consider disease as well as the process of cure at dynamic level. And this is what even Mother and Sri Aurobindo, they have said. So Sri Aurobindo has done a lot of observations even on homeopathy also. I think we have published it in journal, like in different context. Sri Aurobindo has commented on homeopathy and the process of cure involved in homeopathy. Especially Nirodha used to ask him questions, and those question and answers, it's a really wonderful write-up we have. So Sri Aurobindo has written about homeopathy that it is dealing the individual at very subtlest level. So it is having deeper most impact with homeopathic medicines in the process of cure. So in coming years, we have started, like everyone is realizing that at dynamic level, when we treat the person gets cured at a deeper level. See, we don't know like how far we can prolong the life or longevity wise, but definitely the quality of life will be much, much better with this sort of treatment when it is based on totality and it is at dynamic level.
Can you go a little deeper into the dynamic level for us?
Yes, actually, I'll tell you a few examples.
Yes, yes.
See, body has wonderful potential to maintain the health, to preserve the health, as well as even to eradicate the diseases. Wonderful potential body has. I shall give you a few examples. Like we had a patient from Ambala, and she met an accident, and she had broken her bone, which got dislodged from the place, and around 2 inches away it was. And when they realized, they said, no, it has to be operated, and this piece is totally dislodged, and it has to be removed. But they did not have time. They had to come to Pondicherry, their booking. They said, if it is not serious, we can do it later. And the orthopedician said, okay, we can do it even after 2 months. So he just plastered it because the fracture was there in the vicinity. And she came to Pondicherry and she said, okay, we'll have homeopathy then. Anyway, it is plastered and after 2 months we are going to remove it. For fast healing, you give homeopathic medicines. And we gave routine homeopathic medicines on the basis of her constitution. And surprisingly, when she went back and they said, now we have enough time to operate it. And there they found that this bone, piece of bone, was spontaneously manipulated and it came to the right place and it got healed. Can you imagine?
Really?
So this happens. Body has that potential. So doctors have started realizing it. Another one incident I remember, in one periphery, one 3 years aged girl, she had swallowed a hook. The hook in window with the one side as a screw and one side round.
Yeah.
to that window stopper that
Right.
we have. So she had swallowed, and the another child was telling the parents that she has swallowed it, but the child did not have pain, and the parents were worried. So they took her to medical college in Ambajogai. Our place has a medical college, and they x-rayed, and really she had swallowed. No pain, nothing. But the surgeon was wise. He said, if we start operating now, it will travel further in intestine. Like if you try to approach, the muscles have a spontaneous action and it goes further. So they said, we won't disturb it, intervene, unless it gets stuck somewhere. And she was kept for observation in the medical college. One end was sharp and the other end blunt. Can you imagine? The hook came out in the stools without having a single prick or bleeding in the child. So body...
How many days it took?
Hardly 24 hours. The child was kept in medical college, constantly they were observing, and it came out next day. So the blunt end was advancing,
yeah.
and the sharp end was as a tail.
Yes.
And absolutely no pain, nothing. Child was happily kept in the medical college under observation, and it came out. So body
so not given any medicine.
No medicine. So body has wonderful potential. Only thing is we have to allow it to work.
Yes.
How much the fear affects the healing process? In the patient.
Certainly, yes, yes. Actually, you know what we call it? The the willpower of the person is the main entity which is responsible for healing.
For healing.
For healing.
Mm-hmm.
Because that willpower is the main actually area where a person gets affected. So if person has a strong will, we call it sometimes in our pathological term susceptibility. So if person has good susceptibility for cure, there would be very good response to medicines. But if the person has lost will, if negativities are so much, definitely it is it gives limitation to the cure.
So how do you motivate the patient who is having fear?
In homeopathy, what we try to do is we work out a remedy, and in homeopathy we have remedies for even such disorders where the people have a depressive tendency or like fear. So we try to match a remedy which covers the symptoms or the behavioral disposition of the person, and they're like treating claustrophobia. So sometimes when we treat the person with our homeopathic medicines, for the person can take it easily. They can take a flight, or they can be on high place without any fear.
When homeopathic is not working on a patient, do you prescribe allopathic or something else?
See, we have a set rule like, if it is a life-saving measure, like suppose our homeopathic cure is going to take a lot of time, and if there would be some other secondary effect or a side effect, if the person doesn't get relief, and it's like life-threatening, so we allow a palliation, because patient has to be alive. Like for a simple example, if person has a severe diarrhea, so we allow them to take IV fluids and all. So homeopathic medicines alone will not help. Sometimes if the disease phenomena is so advanced that our homeopathic medicines will not have even time to get response, there we allow palliation with allopathic intervention. And once the patient is stable, then we add homeopathic medicines.
Mm-hmm. And how, in general, how long does it take for homeopathic medicine to affect the person with some serious illness?
See, that again,
I know that's a general question.
Yes, but that again depends on susceptibility. But as a rule, it shouldn't take much time. Homeopathic actions are instant action. Within minutes, we get action.
Oh.
if it is warranted and if it is, like, see, body or the susceptibility has to be there in the patient. Like, for a very simple example, I'll tell you. In body also, there is a feedback mechanism working. If the system recognizes a crisis, then the response is quick. If the system doesn't realize the crisis, the response will be slow. Very simple example, like in our house, if we sight a rat, so we won't invest much time and energy in looking for that rat. But suppose you suspect that a snake has been there. So you will devote ample of time and energy to chase it off. Same way in body also. If it is like a life-threatening crisis, body reacts very swiftly. But if it is a minor thing, body doesn't react. And this happens when suppose there is a corn or a skin lesion, mm-hmm. which doesn't bother much.
Mm.
Then the system will not respond to homeopathic medicines quickly. But say if it is a pneumonia or say 104 degree Fahrenheit fever, body will start responding within minutes to homeopathic medicines.
The general people say that homeopathy takes longer time to heal than allopathy medicines.
It's a wrong conception. Like you see, in homeopathy what happens, you know, we don't remove the disease phenomena actually. We try to eradicate the condition which has harbored this illness. We try to root it out from root. So it takes time. But if it is warranted, susceptibility is good, homeopathic cures are much faster than even allopathic medicine. Only thing is, we don't have palliation. See, what happens, like, suppose there is fever. In tuberculosis you get fever, in pneumonia you get fever, in abscess you get fever, in so many conditions you get fever. So in homeopathy, when we are treating the person having fever, the cause of the fever would be taken care of first and then the fever. Because fever is again a defensive mechanism getting roused. Whereas in allopathy, what happens, fever is there, give antipyretic, fever will be down, irrespective of the cause of the fever. So in homeopathy, we don't have symptomatic treatment like that. We have the treatment based on totality. So the cause of the fever will be taken care of first and then the fever.
As an example, the cause of a certain fever?
Yes, like suppose there is an abscess, pus somewhere. And the pus is again a sepsis, and in such condition what happens, body tries to encapsulate that area to protect the surrounding tissue. And this inflammatory reaction results into fever in general. Even if it is in one location, the whole body will develop fever. So in such conditions what happens, homeopathy tries to hasten the process of encapsulation and protection, and then the abscess is matured, the whole body is protected, and then the fever subsides. But in an allopathic, what happens, if fever is there, they will give antipyretic and fever will go down. So people will think it is a quick relief. But finally, this abscess process will be intervened and it will take longer time. So then this abscess has to be drained by surgeon, then lot of gauze pieces and many weeks it will take. So it will be apparently a quick relief, but it's not a quick relief. So yeah. We always call ideal cure as rapid, gentle and permanent. These three criteria are there. It should be rapid, it should be gentle and it should be permanent. So all these three criteria, if you apply, homeopathy will be the quickest way to cure.
So homeopathy goes for the root to clear everything,
exactly.
Whereas allopathy just gives a temporary relief.
Nowadays, good allopaths are following that. See, good allopaths are following that. I remember, like any good physician, see, MD medicine physician gets a case of epistaxis, like bleeding from nose. So first thing they will do is, they will check the blood pressure. They will check the blood pressure before stopping that bleeding. because they know that it can be a vent. Body has found out if it is sudden hypertension, and if it is a threatened apoplexy or hemorrhage in the brain, body finds out vent through nose. So good physician will always see why this bleeding has come and then only stop. So good allopaths are doing it. I remember here, like my friend who had developed hypercholesterolemia, dyslipidemia, his cholesterol levels were raised. The physician said, we won't react to this, we will find out why it is raised. And then all other investigations were done, thyroid profile was done, and he was in hypothyroid state. So his thyroid was corrected and this lipids got all right. So there, good allopaths will follow this.
Now you use a technical term, susceptibility. Is that synonymous with receptivity in any way?
Yes, sensitivity or receptivity.
Okay.
Because susceptibility is used in actually different contexts sometimes. Like suppose, what happens, suppose I catch some infection, some bacteria, and I don't develop any defensive mechanism. And bacteria enter my lungs, they start developing disease phenomena there, and then once the disease has already settled there and a lot of damage is done, then I start producing symptoms. So there, in pathological terms, I was more susceptible to that infection, or I am easily susceptible to that infection. But when we consider sensitivity, there in the context is that if bacterial organisms are trying to enter, my lymphoid tissue in the throat itself will arrest it. And with that susceptibility, or we call sensitivity, the infection will be taken care of at that level without allowing to settle. So susceptibility actually means capability to react.
Okay.
Capability to react.
Are there many cases where it's very difficult to diagnose?
Yes, yes.
Can you give us some examples?
See, there are some cases where, you know, body, see, we try to study clinically all the symptoms. And body will know it first. Before any machine, body should recognize these things first. But in some cases, what happens, we can't explain why it happens. In some cases, body does not react at all to the disease phenomenon. I mean, doesn't develop any symptom. So we don't suspect any disorder. And when the body starts developing symptoms or reacting to the disease phenomena, it is already too late.
Okay.
Body fails to take cognizance. It is definitely somewhere, it is a disease phenomena again. That body instrument fails to recognize the danger of the disease producing. Of course, there can be even dynamic causes, because easily body will not allow such disease to thrive in the body. But suppose because of some stress, if body is occupied so much into other things, body may not be able to heed to these disease phenomena going on in the body. And once it is too late, maybe body will start developing symptoms. So in terminal pathologies like cancers, it happens.
Detection is often too late.
Yes. Detection, when it is detected, it is already late.
Okay.
Unless it is in the periphery, somewhere superficial. Internally, when cancer starts actually occurring, that phenomena, body fails to recognize it.
From your own inner understanding, can you give us some thoughts on cancer itself?
See, hypothetically, cancer is supposed to actually it's a phenomena in the body. After all, cancer is something, a growth in the own tissues beyond control. Regeneration is a routine phenomena in our system. And every cell is regenerated, renovated, almost on an average every 4 months. Every 4 months the cell is new. And it is a well organized phenomena in the system that it multiplies, it regenerates, it matures, it disintegrates. This phenomena is going on. And whole logistic structure is there, like that cell gets blood supply, then cell is connected with our central system, each cell. But in somewhere, this phenomena goes beyond control. Under some delusion, maybe body under delusion, the multiplication becomes faster. Before it is matured, it starts getting multiplied. And because of this, the immature cells, neoplastic cell or mature cells, start multiplying. And then after a certain point, body can't control it. That is the cancer phenomena. But actually we have started realizing that whenever the person comes under some tremendous stress where his system can't have it or bear with it, then all such phenomena go haywire, they go beyond control, and person doesn't have susceptibility to control it.
It's a very interesting thing that you say, and I'm sharing this with everyone because Huta told me one day, Mother said cancer is a psychological disease.
Yes, yes.
Few people want to hear that.
See, like I remember, it was in 81, 82, I had a case where this lady in Maharashtra, we call them Bala Vidwa. The lady became a widow before attaining her puberty. She was married as a child and her husband died, and that in that community the remarriage was not the custom, not allowed by the custom. And somehow her brother helped her to get rehabilitated. Like she was trained as a craft teacher and she started doing job, and at the age of 32-33 she developed breast tumor. And that they did not realize that it should be malignancy. They operated and then they realized that it was a malignant tumor. And that surgical, the wound was not healing. Where the surgery was conducted, mm-hmm. that wound was not healing, and for that she came to our clinic for that wound healing. And she said, no, I don't want to spend anywhere, and I would like to have homeopathy. And we started treating her symptomatically, total, on the basis of totality we took the case. And can you imagine, it took more than 6-7 years to heal her wound. And but she was very firm, and we were telling her that you continue with our treatment. Every year she used to come and ask me that should I give admission to students in her tailoring class. We used to tell her, okay, in between something happens, don't worry, they are not going to chase you in heaven. So you continue so long as you are able to work. And she was working with that ulceration, dressing every day with homeopathic medicines. And after 6-7 years, that thing stopped. That ulceration went off, it was healed, everything. And every year we were reviewing her case. And in one camp, we presented her case to some allopathic surgeons. And our surgeon was asking me, oh, wonderful, who has done this mastectomy? Very nicely removed. Her breast was totally gone with ulceration in about 5-6 years, as if a surgeon has operated it on. And she lived, finally she retired, because after 58, they don't allow one to work as a craft teacher in government institutions. And she retired without anything, no complication. So she was working as a counselor to the patients who were diagnosed as cancer, telling them, see, I am diagnosed as a, having a cancer, and that too bad cancer where it was not healing for years, and I am still there without anything. So actually the willpower, no?
Yes, yes.
It
back
really
to that,
helps.
Yes.
She had a tremendous willpower to...
Willpower, yes. She was like that innocence, the firmness, and then when the surgeon scared her, no, you should go for like radiotherapy or chemotherapy and all, she said, no, I don't want. I'm happy. Doesn't matter. How much is the life, 1 year, 2 years, I'm happy. Because I don't want to go through all such hassle. And whatever life I have, I will enjoy it. I'm working, 8 hours she was working, and she lived for so many years, and finally she retired and went off to her brother's place.
I should think that reading the mother on the transformation work on her cells must be very interesting for you.
Yes.
Can
yes.
you speak a little bit about that?
So that is what actually hypothetically, even in medical languages also, we say that body has tremendous potential. Tremendous potential. Now this potential in the sense that finally the person starts realizing the purpose of life. What happens, like when I studied my post-graduation, my topic of my dissertation was impact of an illness on development of the personality. And I interviewed 180 patients with serious illnesses, which they have undergone serious illnesses. And finally, everyone was concluding that my progress was enhanced by my illness. I am altogether a different person. I am far, far better person because of that illness. Had that illness been not there, I would not have been this person. So finally what happens, you know, each event, why illness, each event in the life has impact, and if the person realizes it as an unprejudiced observer, will find that it is having better impact.
If could we even say takes it as a blessing, or is that too far?
Yeah. That may be too far. We can't call it a grace or a blessing.
Okay, all right.
But definitely it can't be the hindrance in progress.
Mm-hmm.
It can't be the hindrance in progress.
Okay.
Because in homeopathy also we say that the main aim of the highest aim of the person is to divinize oneself. Become better and better human being. Same concept.
Is,
like
that, is that a tenet of homeopathy? I mean, like...
See, Hahnemann has written The Organon of Medicine, the book on homeopathic philosophy.
Mm-hmm.
That actually gives all these points.
Oh.
Yes, yes. That's what we found, that so much similarity between homeopathic philosophy and Mother and Sri Aurobindo's teachings. So this transformation, like Mother has written about it, they have demonstrated in many people, that definitely the transformation is possible, and it can be, like we can say, accelerated by even homeopathic medicines.
So back to the cellular transformation, which I have read Mind of the Cells many times, and would like you to comment on perhaps the future body, if you have any thoughts on that.
Yeah,
not to put you on the spot.
See, future of the body is, you know, enormous scope is there. Like we used to read, you know, in Lobsang Grandpa's book about Tibetan lamas.
Yes, yes.
And there he has given, in one paragraph he writes like what discussions are going on in Tibet. That there people are talking, gossiping among themselves that there is a community somewhere in the world where there is a instrument called as a tap. You put one bucket and the water comes there. So wonderful it is, because they have to hunt for water so long there. And here in developed countries, they are gossiping that there are some human beings as lamas, where they can have telepathic communication thousands of kilometers, they can travel, they can witness the whole world in one view. So much abilities they have. And both of them are wondering for each other. So in future, definitely, as Mother also has said, that we will get, you know, like minimum quantity of food will be able to comply the body's requirements. Then people will be more and more capable for work without much physical exertion. So definitely that world will come. Even in medicines also, now those micro doses are coming, even in allopathy also nowadays, like they give medicine once in a month. So in homeopathy also, some of the single dose therapies, like one dose you give and it should continue for to work for even 4 months, 5 months, or till the cure is there.
I see.
So
can you throw some light when it is homeopathy began in India, and how this homeopathy medicine is prepared off? So I'm curious to know.
See, homeopathic medicines are prepared from plants, animals, even in ponderabilia, some energies also. The main difference is all homeopathic medicines are proved and studied on healthy human beings, not on rat or rabbits and all, on healthy human beings. You know how homeopathic principle was invented. This Samuel Hahnemann was basically an allopathic doctor. He was a medical practitioner. And he got disgusted with the failures and the pain. That time the medical practice also was a bit crude only, very crude. So he stopped practicing. And he was multilinguistic. So he started translating some books to earn his living. He said it is better than practicing such a raw practice. And he was translating one Materia Medica, and there he was writing about malaria. Quinine cures malaria. And they had reasoned out, because quinine is bitter, it cures malaria. He said, what that bitterness has to do with cure, the potential to cure. So he himself consumed little bit of quinine. And to his surprise, he developed malaria-like symptoms, which eventually subsided when he stopped taking it. Then he gave this quinine to many other healthy people around him. And to his surprise, everyone developed a malaria-like syndrome. And then he thought that maybe this quality of quinine to produce malaria-like syndrome must be the curative property of quinine, which cures malaria. And then he tried so-called, like some drugs were being used, those on healthy human beings. And he realized that the condition which they are supposed to cure, that condition is created artificially in that person as a drug effect. So all homeopathic medicines are essentially proved on healthy human beings. Sometimes intentional provings and sometimes accidental provings. For example, like snake bite. Now, snake bite.
I was just going to ask about that.
Snake bite. It gives toxic effects, symptoms, and all. So, same poison, it is dynamized and used in micro doses and given as a remedy when that type of symptoms are found in the patient. So, even deadliest poisonous snake venom is used for making medicine, but it is in a very, very attenuated form. Attenuated in the sense it is diluted to the highest extent, where after certain level it is difficult to even identify the ingredients beyond the molecular level.
I see.
Yes. Actually, that is the area where, you know, people are criticizing homeopathy, that it doesn't contain any medicine. But as a clinician, we always say that, see, like we are using cell phones, we are using TV, we are using camera, without understanding how it works. But it works, and we use it. Now, how it works and all, it is left to scientists to find out, to be found out, actually. So here, in homeopathic medicines, what we do is we go on diluting so much that only when the person is susceptible, it will act. Suppose, like one medicine, see, it is very easy to understand. Like, if the person has developed a syndrome, like one disease phenomena, that means naturally the person was susceptible. Because there are thousands of people around, and why this person alone has suffered? That means he bears the susceptibility. So if we find out a drug which has capability of producing such syndrome in healthy human beings, and that drug is given in minutest doses, also this person will have susceptibility, whereas other people may not have susceptibility for it. So in homeopathy, the best advantage is that the drugs are attenuated or diluted, or we call it potentized, to the highest level. And when we give this remedy to the person who has indications, he will respond, whereas the other person who doesn't have indications will not respond. He will find it as a very inert thing, substance.
So if one gave quinine in this lowest possible dosage to a healthy person, they wouldn't?
No, they will get health, lowest possible means crude dose. So that will act in everyone.
Okay.
But homeopathic medicines which we attenuate, dilute or potentize, then each person will not be susceptible.
Okay.
Only the person who has natural disease which is similar to that will be susceptible.
Or an inclination towards it or not?
Inclination doesn't matter, because we are using medicines in veterinary also. In cattle we use, and they are very effective.
Okay.
Only symptom similarity is the criteria, that it should match the susceptibility. And therefore there was a criticism on homeopathy, that people were telling that Natromur 1M, we all 1,000 people will come and consume and we'll see the effect. And they will never have effect, because they are not susceptible. But the person who has the syndrome of Natromur in natural course will definitely respond in one dose. Yes. If susceptibility is there, one dose will suffice. But then, you know, in homeopathy what happens, you can't have a specific remedy for one disease. Like person having typhoid. Now, if there are four persons having typhoid, four different remedies will be indicated, depending upon their own individuality. So it is not possible that, okay, for typhoid you get it. This is specific remedies is not a possibility in homeopathy.
So every case is different.
Every case.
So broad, sorry.
Yes, yes. That is the limitation of homeopathy, where homeopath has to work on that individual and work out a remedy.
So there never is a broad spectrum cure?
No, no.
Okay.
There can't be a specific remedy for specific pathology. There would be remedy which is specific to that person having that pathology.
So how do you decide this? Sometime homeopathy, they give strong dose, mild dose. How you decide? By studying the...
These are all misnomers, actually. See, strong dose, in the sense, some people call it higher potencies. But what we do is, we try to work out the sensitivity or susceptibility level of the person through symptomatology. And the potency also has to be matching with the sensitivity of the person. For a very simple example, suppose I am to give this China, quinine or Natromur, some medicine to the person. Suppose there are two persons belonging to same remedy, means indicating same remedy. But one person has developed all the aspects of the remedy to the finest extent. That person has developed all the similar symptoms to this remedy. then that means the person has higher sensitivity. So there we would go for higher potency. Low potencies will not work. Whereas some person who has developed only common symptoms and not all finer symptoms, there the same remedy has to be given in low potency. So potency also has to match with the person along with the remedy.
So how do you prepare this the medicine? You prepare it according to the nature of the person?
No. Medicines are independently proved and prepared.
Mm-hmm.
We just match the symptomatology of the person
mm-hmm.
with the symptomatology of the drug. See, the funniest part is our study of materia medica is just study of artificial patient. Means we give the medicine to the healthy human being, not one, we give to many. And then study the effects. And it is as good as a case taking and interpretation and having the totality. So we can definitely match the level of sensitivity by studying the symptomatology. So we don't study according to the patients having the symptoms. We study all the remedies on healthy human beings, but they are verified
mm-hmm.
in clinical practice.
So why all homeopathy tablets are sweet?
Actually what happens, we make dilutions in rectified spirit, 95.5. Aldehyde free, we call it extra neutral alcohol. In that we prepare dilutions. All these globules, lactose globules, are moistened with that dilution. So globules are same as vehicle. So on those vehicle, we impregnate those vehicles with medicines. So they look alike. Only the dilutions, even dilutions look alike beyond certain potency. You can't detect the original drug.
But he's asking about sweetness.
They are lactose. They are all of lactose.
Oh, it's all out of lactose.
So lactose, that is
okay.
Those pellets, are of lactose. Or even cane sugar. Some people.
I see.
So that's why they are sweet.
So diabetic patients, how far it is effective, the homeopathy? I mean, can it be cured?
See, diabetes again is a metabolic disorder and it is a complex. Two diabetics, the pathogenesis is not same. Pathogenesis is different in different people. And in diabetes what happens, under some delusion, the system of the person has preferred or opted for increased level of blood sugar. It's a very complex thing.
I see.
And therefore they say, stress, because see in brain, human brain, all the calories are obtained from carbohydrates, not from fat or protein. Carbohydrates are essential for brain's working. So where the person is under mental stress, his sugar, the carbohydrate requirement itself is more. So it's a very complex phenomena. So here what happens, if it is a stress diabetes, or it is like acquired or as a compromised body has produced under delusion, then it is curable. But if it is a inherited metabolic disorder which has started a few generations earlier and now it is surfacing, then it may not reverse. But we have conducted experiments, like if the person has diabetic potential, we can say. See, there are in inheritance also, inheritance is a contribution of seven generations in genetics. Means from seven generations, the genes are transmitted. So there are few people in the tree who do not have diabetes. So definitely that potential also is there. So definitely, like if the person is to have diabetes, say at the age of 50, and with constitutional homeopathic treatment, person will not develop it even up to 70. Same is the case with cataract, diabetes, hypertension and all.
So So that can be
yes.
delayed, prevented.
Yes, yes. It can be controlled, it can be delayed, it can be even kept dormant for whole life. So we have cases where they had pregnancy diabetes, who had stress diabetes. They never got diabetes under homeopathy.
So only if they inform me before and it is my father having diabetes, I may have it, then the treatment will be easier.
Generally what happens, cases coming to us, they are labeled as diabetics and immediately started with hypoglycemic agents or insulin therapies. And once they undergo hypoglycemic agent therapy or insulin therapy to control blood sugar levels, the body becomes dependent to that also.
Mm-hmm.
And then to withdraw it or bring them out of that is very difficult. Otherwise, fresh cases, we generally don't ask them to take hypoglycemic agent. We just try to distress them, give constitutional remedy. And there are many people who don't require it. Same is the case with even higher cholesterol. We don't allow them to take medicines for cholesterol. Statins we don't allow.
This has been a wonderful, wonderful evening.
Thank
and you.
You
have enlightened us greatly.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Did you bring a still camera?
Yeah, another thing I wanted to ask you about, I mean, if heart attack is hereditary, so that can be delayed by medicine.
You see, heart attack again.
Can just,
we can sit down.
See, in heart attack, especially if it is a coronary block, that again is a very complex process. Getting coronary block is again a complex process. So generally person again undergoing so many shocks or stress, they actually are prone for coronary blocks. So definitely with homeopathic medicines, what happens, actually the environment is same for everyone. So everyone remaining in that situation will not react in that fashion. So it is again individuality of the person to develop those coronary blocks. So definitely if we start treating on constitutional line, person will never develop coronary blocks. I had one case earlier, we used to tell that for coronary block cases we never intervene because of its serious sequelae. And I had one allopathic doctor friend who had heart attack at the age of 35. And he was working in a primary health center in periphery, very busy practitioner, and he had coronary block and heart attack, and he was managed conservatively, and he was given side post for 5 years, and he was all right with that. And then he wanted again post on the busy clinic, and the director said, no, unless you go for angiography test, we won't allow you to work on busy clinic. And that time, he went to Bombay for having angiography, and the cardiothoracic surgeon who conducted this process, he told, you are lucky that you did not come before 5 years to us. Because his one major branch of coronary artery was 100% blocked. 100% blocked. But the coronary circulation had already set in. Means he was telling nature has done bypass. So in our system, what happens in coronary circulation, collateral circulation, that is delayed. Elsewhere it is very easy, but there slowly it takes place. So if the blocks occur very slowly, then even collateral circulation also is there as a compensatory phenomenon, body adapts, and maybe in some time, even if 100% the vessel is blocked, the collateral circulation compensates and person is healthy. So when the person in general is healthy, is definitely able to cope up with such situation. So constitutional homeopathic therapies definitely help in coping up with even that tendency. And anyway, now angioplasty with stent or without stent or even bypass, it takes care of only one site, whereas there would be multiple blocks.
Mm-hmm.
So best would be a constitutional conservative treatment. But if it is an emergency, say like block is beyond 80% and that too in a major vessel,
mm-hmm.
we allow them to undergo this. But if person asks me that should I go for angiography, I say don't go for it. Consider that you have block, coronary block, and manage it well, conservatively. But if the person has already undergone angiography and major vessel is blocked, and then psychologically also person has pressure,
mm-hmm.
so we allow them to, but they have to again undergo same therapy because further blocks we have to prevent.
Mother says somewhere that it is finally fate that cures. So how effective it is if one, you know, doesn't take the treatment and solely goes on mother's faith?
We take the other way. See, faith is essential, not necessarily in homeopathic medicines. Faith in oneself, that willpower, because homeopathy works through own healing process. So that will has to be strong. The will of the person to be individual, should have self-confidence and will to survive, and then faith in oneself. Person may not have, may be just ignorant about homeopathy, may not know anything about homeopathy. Not necessarily that person should have faith on doctor or homeopathy. Person should have faith on oneself, and that will should be strong. That's the main thing. That is what we have seen. Because person who doesn't have faith will not be able to divulge you proper totality also. And unless the person is interested and gives proper totality, you will not be able to work out homeopathic medicine also.